Last time we talked about region-based analysis and how it can help integrate a data flow analysis with more precise symbolic analyses for internal to regions. Now, before we go any further, we need to understand what do I mean by a region, and it needs to be defined more formally. Recall that a program is viewed as a hierarchy of regions. And roughly speaking, a region is the portion of a flow graph that has only one point of entry. So not every portion of the control flow graph is a region. It needs to have a property, and the property is that it only has one point of entry. Notice that this is very similar to the requirement we had for a natural loop. A natural loop is a cycle which has only one point of entry. Similarly, a region is a portion of the program. It need not be a loop, it need not be a cycle, but a portion of program that has only one point of entry. So consider a block structured program, like the one we write in a high-level language like C. We could have curly braces, and so in this kind of structure, each of these blocks forms a region, and this nesting of blocks forms a region hierarchy, right? Because it's not possible to jump to the middle of a block. Right, and in any case, these high-level languages do not provide you constructs to allow you to do arbitrary jumps. You can only do jumps like using control flow structures like if-then-else, for loop, while loop, and so on. And all such loops basically create scoped regions, nested scoped regions. And these scoped regions basically form regions, you know, regions in our region-level analysis sense, because they will only have a single entry. So in this figure that I draw, you know, you can imagine that these extra scopes are being created because of statements like if then else or for or whatever. And so each of these scopes can form a single region. More formally, a region is a collection of nodes N and edges E, such that, and these nodes and edges must be a subset of the nodes and edges of the entire control flow graph. And there are more requirements, such that there is a header H belonging to the set of nodes N that dominates all nodes in N, and this basically encodes our single entry condition. So H should be our single entry point into this region, and the way to say that is that H should dominate all the other nodes in that particular region. Second, if there is some node M that can reach node N belonging to capital N without going through H, then M also belongs to N. So all the nodes that can reach any node in the region without going through H should also belong to the region. This is exactly like our natural loop definition. It basically means that if there are two nodes that, you know, where one node can reach another node without going through the header of the region or the dominating node of the region H, then, you know, that node, like all such nodes should be a part of the region. So this is just saying that a region should be the maximal such entity which is dominated by H, and such that they can reach, you know, one can reach the other. All right, so that's just about what nodes to include in the region, and so what edges to include in the region. That's also easy. From the nodes, the edges largely follow. E is the set of all control flow edges between nodes N1 and N2 in N, except possibly for some that enter H. So basically, once we have identified all the nodes in the region, basically first we identify the header that dominates all the other nodes in that particular region. Firstly, we decide what do we want to call a region, right? Maybe we want to call every block a region or something like that. We want to call every loop a region. We're going to discuss how to identify regions or what regions to choose very soon. But let's say once I have identified a region and I identified a header of the region, if I want to identify all the nodes of a region, I just basically look for nodes that can reach other nodes in the region without going through H. Once I identify all the nodes, maximal such set, we identify all the nodes in the region, then all the edges that kind of go between these nodes of the region are also the edges of the region itself. So E is the set of all control flow edges between nodes N1 and N2 in N. So if both N1 and N2 belong to N, then any edge between N1 and N2 belongs to the region as well. But possibly, it is possible that I define a region which excludes some no edges that enter H. So it is possible that N1 belongs to N, H belongs to N, there's an edge from N1 to H, and yet I exclude it from the region. And so we're going to see how an example of that. So here are some examples of regions. A natural loop is a region, and you would see that the definition of a region actually is complete agreement with the definition of a natural loop. There is a single entry point, and all the nodes that can reach any other node in the region without going through edge, the single entry point, are also part of the region, and that's exactly what the loop says. And then all the edges that go between any two nodes inside the region are part of the region, and that's also part of a natural loop. A basic block is a region. Recall that a basic block has a single entry point, and it's a straight line sequence of code. And so, once again, it's a maximal straight line sequence of code, and so that defines a region as well. A single statement is a region. A single statement is the smallest region that you can have, because it has a single entry point and it has only one node. So, so there can be multiple ways in which I can construct the region. And actually, there are more regions that can be identified in most programs. For example, we just looked at this example of block structure. So in these examples that I'm using, natural loop, basic block, and single statement, I'm not actually considering regions that are being created because of other blocks and things like that. Language level scoping blocks, I'm not considering that, but you can create more regions. And you can have a hierarchy of regions, whatever choice of regions you take. And for example, you could say that the highest level regions are natural loops, and then basic blocks, and then single statements. And above the natural loop, you have a procedure, just like we had discussed in the previous module. Notice that the definition of a region also allows me to call the body of a natural loop without the back edge to be a region. So the acyclic region within a loop. So here is an example of a loop, and this particular edge going from the last node to the header of the loop is the back edge, right? So this is the back edge. And notice that the green square that I have drawn represents a region, and that is not including the back edge. And I'm claiming that even this green edge, green circle, is a region. So of course, if I draw the larger circle, which includes the back edge, that is also a region. But the inner green rectangle is also a region. And these are two separate regions. And why is the inner green rectangle a region? Because it satisfies all our properties. It has a single entry point, which is also the header of the loop and the header of the loop body. Notice that the body of a natural loop is different from the loop in the sense that the loop also includes the back edge. The body doesn't include the back edge, and there could be multiple back edges. So the body doesn't include any of the back edges. And so in this, we satisfy that property. It's also true that if there's a node that can reach any other node in the region without going through edge, then that node is also part of the region. So, for example, both these nodes are part of the region. And then all edges that are kind of between nodes of the region are part of the region, except potentially some edges that are entering the header of the region, H. And so in this case, that except possibly some edges that are entering the header. And so here I'm using that particular definition to exclude the back edge, and yet the loop body can be called a region. Okay, so recall that was the significance of that particular clause, that it is possible that some edges that are entering the header of the region and which start from one of the nodes in the region are not included in the region, and yet it could be called a region. And so I'm calling the body of a natural loop a region. Okay, and we're going to see that this is actually useful as we're going to discuss region-based analysis in future. What is the typical region hierarchy? So right now I have just defined regions in the most general way. What are all the possible regions that can be constructed out of a program, of a control flow graph. And based on the choice of regions, you also create a region hierarchy. But typically, what do compilers do? Because there's such a large space of what regions could be. Typically, compilers use procedure bodies as regions. Procedure bodies satisfy all our constraints. The entry can only be at the beginning of the procedure body. Natural loops, their bodies, and the associated hierarchy. All right. So natural loops and the associated hierarchy. So if I have a natural loop, I create a region out of it and in my region hierarchy. And any nested loops create separate regions, and then they participate in the region hierarchy, as we saw in the last module. I should also add here that natural loops and their bodies, and their loop bodies. Right? As we saw in our previous slide, loop bodies form regions of themselves, and in this case the loop body would be a sub-region of the loop itself, right? And the difference between the loop body and the loop itself would be the absence of the back edges of that particular loop. The next level of regions is basic blocks, and the final level of regions is the individual statements. And so this is exactly like the example that we had discussed in our previous module, and this happens to be the typical way of demarcating regions by compilers. How does the compiler decide how to demarcate the regions? Well, before we discuss that, I want to share an example of a portion of the control flow graph that is not a region. So, example, in this particular control flow graph, this gray rectangle is not a region because there are two entry points, one at this node and one at this node. So this is not a region. On the other hand, if I look at this particular control flow graph, if I use this particular rectangle, then this is a region because there's only one entry point. Notice that there are potentially two exits, but there is only one entry point. And so this can be called a region. And so, you know, even though this can be called a region and this is a region, it's not necessary that the compiler chooses to make a region out of this. And as we discussed in the last slide, compiler chooses only specific types of regions and not necessarily all the possible regions that are possible in the control flow graph. Regions should be, how does the compiler decide how to choose regions? Well, regions should be chosen to try and produce more precise transfer functions. So the whole idea of demarcating regions is that we can do some symbolic analysis on that particular region or some other kind of sophisticated analysis to produce better summary functions than what a fixed point iteration DFA would have produced for that sub-region. And so here is an example of a region for constant propagation. Let's say I have this diamond-shaped structure of a control flow graph. I've used this example before. On the left side, we have x equals 2, y equals 3. On the right side, we have y equals 2, x equals 3. And at the midpoint, I have z equals x plus y. Now, if I run a basic data flow analysis graph, I'm going to get z equals bottom, right, for DFA. But if I use a summary symbolic analysis based data flow graph transfer function for this, I can get z equals 5. And so in this particular case, it would help to create a region out of these four blocks as demarcated by this gray rectangle. And so ideally we want to identify regions or demarcate regions so that the associated transfer function for that region through our more sophisticated symbolic analysis is more precise than the transfer function that is obtained by your vanilla DFA analysis. In general, that is a pretty hard thing to do, to identify all such places where the transfer function is going to give you a more precise answer. And so compilers would typically ignore such regions and they would just use a heuristic to just say, okay, let's just consider all the loops as regions, and then maybe all the loop bodies as regions, and then all the basic blocks as separate regions, and so on. And so within those regions, they can do symbolic analysis, and sometimes they may miss out on opportunities like this one, right? So although regions give you a framework to do more precise analysis, the choice of regions is still heuristic based, and because of that, you can still have imprecision in your analysis.